Welcome everyone, buongiorno a tutti, buon pomeriggio, anzi, and welcome. Good afternoon everyone from Alessandro Ruggera from the Istituto Italiano di Cultura, and glad to have you here for this chat under the volcano. It's a lovely opportunity we have. I mean, you probably know that a couple of days ago would have been the date for the fifth concert of the season, the last concert of the season for the Vesuvius Ensemble. And unfortunately, due to reasons that we all know, and we are all confined at home, so there's no way to be in presence and to assist to a concert. And I reiterate what I've been saying in all the webinars that we have organized in the past few weeks. We are really looking forward to see you all again in person. But now it's important to stay home and to stay safe and to avoid the spread of the virus. So in a discussion with the members of the Vesuvius Ensemble, that as you know, the Istituto is collaborating with since years and with great pleasure. And I have to say the Istituto is really not only happy, but really honored to be to support this incredible ensemble. So we decided to organize and to have a way to give you the opportunity to meet with the Vesuvius Ensemble in a different way. So it will not be a concert. There's no way to replicate the exact feeling of a live concert, but it's as the title goes, chat under the volcano. So the opportunity to hear directly from the voice of Francesco Pellegrino, singer, tenor, founder member of the Vesuvius Ensemble, Lucas Harris, lute, guitar, and Marco Cera, oboe and charamella mostly, and also mandolin, directly from their voice, the story and sort of presentation on the next season with some example of music that you might have heard this year, and you will probably hear in the next season. So once again, we are looking forward to having again the opportunity to be at a concert, to sit together, to meet in person. But by now, I'm sure you will enjoy this conversation with Vesuvius Ensemble. Keep in mind that you have the opportunity to present some questions to the members of the Vesuvius. You just can use the Q&A tool that you find at the bottom of your screen. And I will repeat the questions. I will rather present the question at the end, but you can send them along the conversation. So enjoy, and now please, Francesco, the floor is yours.
Ciao a tutti, and first of all, thank you, Alessandro. Thank you, the Istituto, to organize this, to give this opportunity to Vesuvius Ensemble to be in touch with our audience. Thank you again, Alessandro. Thank you, Gloria, Ada, Tiziana, to organize and to help technically everything. A special greeting, of course, is going to be to our sponsors, our patrons, and our audience, our fans. During this crazy time, lockdown, they support us really, really encouraging with a lot of messages, emails, phone call, and it was beautiful, it was very emotional, and most of all, it was the request, I hope to see you soon, I hope everything is going to be ending soon, so waiting to understand a little more what's going on, what they will decide for our live concerts. We have ready our next season. We are ready. The 2021 season is ready. And of course, in same time, we don't know what's going on. So that's why we are exploring alternatives such as streaming our concert online, if the audience present in the hall will be reduced, like as we believe. We are exploring different alternatives. So we finished the season, the 19-20. We did just one concert in February, this one. And we canceled two concerts in May. So the last program we did, it was dedicated to the serenades in February. It was called Lo Primo Amore, and it was a big success. We decided to do in October, October 3rd, yes, the concert we canceled in May. It was called So You Wanna Be Americano, because it's a beautiful program and absolutely outstanding music, and we had a we will have the opportunity to have an incredible double bass player, composer, cellist, guest, Andrew Downing. So we decided to do this program we canceled in May to do in October, and dedicated to the Neapolitan music with American influence, because in the city of Naples, until I think 10, 15 years ago, it was a big, huge NATO base. And during the Second World War, many clubs along the port where the American soldiers, they used to go there and play jazz mixed with local musicians. So in particular, the music that was created after the Second World War is an incredible mix, and style mixed a lot of influence. So Renato Carosone created his own brand, new style, which became a huge success and a very popular as it still is today. So this this program, I think, is going to be very, very interesting and funny. So we're going to show you now a video. It's a little surprise. And actually, in this video, you can see some pictures from our guests, Kirk Elliott, and Romina Di Gasbari was a guest too in this program. So, Lucas, I think you can go with the video.
Mais um pouco. Aspetta di mamma non lo fa l'americano, americano, americano. Ma si nati di Italy, si è capito, non ci sta che cava, ok, no. Italy, non lo fa l'americano, tu lo fa l'americano.
My name is Marco Cera. You may know me as a oboist with Baroque Tafel Music Baroque Orchestra, but I am also the co-founder of Vesuvius Ensemble. I come from Italy, from the region of Veneto, and I come from a very musical family. I was trained as a classical musician on the oboe, but always been playing many different instruments, you know, with my family. I met Francesco back in 2007 when I just arrived to Canada to join Tafel Music, and we decided to start this project called the Vesuvius Ensemble. And my connection with Lucas Harris comes from classical music, from Tafel Music. I wanted to say that the beauty of working with this group is that the Vesuvius give us a lot of room to be creative, to discover, to learn, to be inventive. We are sure specialized on Italian Southern music, but the repertoire is so big, so vast, that it gives us the opportunity to investigate different genres of music, many combinations of instruments, many different styles of music. For example, in our past seasons, we always explore music from different times. So we can dedicate a concert to early villanellas from the 16th century, or jump 300 years and explore this music that you just heard from the 1950s. So it never gets boring, for sure. In order to do this, to explore many different repertoires, we need instruments that are appropriate for each program that we are presenting. So I just wanted to show you a couple of instruments that I play. I said that my main instrument is the oboe. And this is an oboe that is a copy of an instrument from the 18th century. And it's a woodwind instrument that is played with a reed, double reed. And this is a charamella, which is, you know, the ancestor of the oboe. And this is the instrument that I basically play with Vesuvius Ensemble, and that gives this very rustic sound to, especially to the Christmas repertoire that we play. In fact, one of the successful appointments that we have for you for the next season, but that we played many times, is this Christmas concert. And of course, Christmas music in Italy equal to pastoral sound of the countryside, the music of the shepherds. And the instrument that represents the shepherds is in Italy is a bagpipe called zampogna, and I'm gonna show you the zampogna. So I hope you can see, this is the zampogna. The traditional bagpipe from Italy. The word zampogna is related to the Greek word symphonia, meaning many sounds played together. In fact, if you see, the instrument has many pipes. Each one is like an individual, has his individual reed inside. And the reeds are attached to this block of wood where the air goes through. And of course, this is the instrument that was played by the shepherds. And the sounds of the zampogna is something really peculiar. And many composers, especially in the Baroque time, like Handel, Bach, Corelli, Tartini, Dall'Abaco, they tried to imitate the sound of the zampogna. The melodies that the zampogna players play are called pastorale. In fact, pastore means shepherd. The zampogna have been always associated with spirituality and religion. And during the novena period, the shepherds, musicians would descend from the mountains to serenade and accompany the prayers, the public prayers. The tradition of zampogna was almost disappearing in Italy. It was in danger of being lost. But luckily, young players like our friend Tommaso Sollazzo, that I say hi, Tommaso, if you are there. Young players, they decided to preserve the tradition of the instrument. Tommaso is our friend from Vallo della Lucania, and we had the privilege to share the stage with him many times, especially during these Christmas concerts that we play every year. Nowadays, the zampogna is popular again among young players, and there are many festivals in Italy in the summer. I suggest looking into the Festival Internazionale della Zampogna, held every year on the last weekend of July in a small town called Scapoli in the province of Isernia, which is part of the region Molise. It's a beautiful little town that gets really active during this festival with many concerts where you can hear players playing this zampogna. So at this point, we would like to share a video clip from a live performance of our Christmas concert that is also available on CD if you don't have it already. The song that we are gonna play is called Dio vi manda l'ambasciata, that translated in English is God sends you a messenger. At the end of this song, Tommaso and I are gonna play attaching a new piece. So you will see at the end of the video that we will stand up and play an instrumental piece where you can appreciate the zampogna and the ceramella paired together. This piece is called, is a fast dance called Mazzurca dei Montesani. So I hope you are gonna enjoy this video clip. Thank you.
Edgar, a Santa Elisabetta, e San Giovanni ancora un serenato, tutti di cui santificato. Vergine casta, costi Maria, io mi consolo, assai con via. Vergine casta, costi Maria, io mi consolo, assai con via.
I'm Lucas Harris, and I just want to thank everybody for coming. As you can see, I haven't quite gotten my COVID haircut yet. My wife Genevieve cut the dog's hair a couple of days ago, and after I saw the results, I thought maybe another solution will present itself. I'm not sure. I hope that everybody watching is managing to stay safe, and that your families are all healthy, and that you're managing to stay positive in this very strange situation we're in. And thank you so much for attending this webinar and giving us a chance to tell you about Vesuvius Ensemble and what our plans are for, you know, whenever things return to normal. And we're certainly working on things even before that. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about a new program that we've done just this past February that we plan to do again, and we even hope that it might become a kind of annual tradition. This is the concert called Lo Primo Amore, The First Love, and this is a Valentine's Day concert of serenades taken from the so-called golden age of Neapolitan song at the turn of the 19th century, so roughly from about 1880 to 1920. We have been working really hard to vary our concerts by having lots of interesting guests. We've had many singers, we've had violinists, cellists, we've had multi-instrumentalists like Ben Grossman and Kirk Elliott. For this concert, we realized that we had a great program that worked brilliantly with just the core Vesuvius trio, so just Francesco and Marco and I. And moreover, we didn't even need to bring lots of instruments to the concert. It was totally enough and perfect to have just voice, guitar, and mandolin. And I was extremely happy to have the chance to play this guitar. This is my Romantic era guitar that was made in Torino in 1831. And I won't tell you the whole story of how I acquired this guitar, but it was restored over a period of 3 years by the Toronto luthier Michael Schreiner. And I just fell in love with it as soon as the restoration was finished and I played the first notes on it. I spend most of my life in the playing music from the 16th and 17th and 18th centuries. And so this program and this guitar have been such a fun opportunity for me to dip my toes in the water of the 19th and 20th centuries. So there are so many great songs from this so-called golden age of Neapolitan song that we're planning to repeat this concert and reprogram some of our favorite songs from this past February, but also add new ones and explore different songs. It's a vast repertoire and it's there's so much good stuff. We're hoping to kind of just make it into a Valentine's Day tradition and keep rotating songs every year. Let's hope that there's a chance that we will be able to do it in February 2021 for a live audience. That would be such a treat. I'll keep my fingers crossed about that. If not, we'll find some way to bring it to you. The canzone napoletana as an art form has a kind of strange duality about it. It's kind of high and low at the same time. So it's composed music, but at the same time, it has obvious similarities to the traditional folk music of Southern Italy. The poetry is, of course, in the beautiful Neapolitan dialect, and at the same time, it's very earthy, but it also has great sophistication. It expresses feelings of unpretentious feelings of love, jealousy, heartache. It often refers metaphorically to simple objects in the natural world, like the sun, the sea, the moon, the flowers, etc. And yet, some of that poetry is just incredibly sophisticated. The songs were typically published with a fully realized piano accompaniment, and yet they're most commonly sung to a more rustic or simple semi-improvised plucked accompaniment of usually the guitar, sometimes mandolin. We see that in the tradition of the posteggiatore, which is the kind of singer guitarist who performs requests at a cafe or a trattoria. And I know Francesco has done some of that kind of work, so he can tell you more about that. In the early 1900s, the great classical tenor Enrico Caruso began to record some of these Neapolitan songs to phonograph records. And those recordings diffused them all around the world, and they made them standard repertoire for operatic tenors. And yet, the greatest exponents of the songs of this period are probably more popular singers like Roberto Muroro or Sergio Bruni. Look those guys up on YouTube if you don't know them. When we prepared our music for this concert, we mostly made transcriptions of old recordings of those singers. I'm going to talk now about the next video that we're going to show you. This is a piece, a song called Shetate, which means wake up. And it's a classic serenade song. So a man in the street is basically singing to a woman outside her window. The composer is Mario Pasquale Costa, and the librettist is Ferdinando Russo. I'll just talk about Costa for a second. He was from Taranto. He was born into a family of musicians, although his father was apparently a customs official. He studied at the San Pietro a Maiella Conservatory in Naples. He had a great tenor voice and he premiered a lot of his own songs. He also lived in London, England for 3 years as a young man when he was in his 20s. And in this concert, Lo Primo Amore, he was the only composer whose music appeared more than once. So we performed three of his songs, Luna Nuova, Era da Maggio, and then the one we're about to play for you, Scegliete. I'm gonna just see if I can do a share screen here, just so I can share the translation with you. And I'll just try to make this full screen. So I hope you can see that. So, si duorme o si non duorme, bella mia, whether you're sleeping or not, my beauty, listen for a moment to my voice. The man who loves you here is in the street to sing you a sweet melody. You were asleep, but now you've woken up. Won't these little windows open for me? It's a beautiful embroidery, this mandolin song. Wake up, my beauty, sleep no more. And I'll just stop there. Because the woman that the speaker is singing to is asleep, or kind of in that state right between being asleep and being awake, Costa gives the music a very sleepy and kind of dreamlike quality. And there are a couple of ways that he does that. He gives the piece a very slow tempo and a kind of very foggy minor tonality. And he also uses some interesting and strange turns of harmony. He alternates between this E minor chord and this chord, which is C7. And you hear that the melody explores this semitone between B and then this A sharp. And one of the reasons I think this is such a cool piece is because that alternation between the B and the A sharp almost feels like you're going in and out of a state of being asleep or being awake. You're kind of exploring the line between those two states. Another interesting, so I don't want to make this into a music theory class, but I'll just mention one other kind of harmonic aspect of the piece. You also get a lot of the so-called Neapolitan sixth. And in the melody, when it goes to the leading tone, rather than this normal, you get this Neapolitan sixth, which is a trick that Neapolitan composers especially have been using since the Baroque period. And it's still taught in modern music theory classes as the so-called Neapolitan sixth. And that is used a lot in this piece to give it that dreamy, mysterious quality. Okay, now I think we're ready for the video.
Oh. sta a sentir che sta canzone. A gente se parla di tre più bella, dicevano c'è tena una passione. E passione da non passa mai, passa lungo sa non passerà. Tu certa chiesta non ci penserai, ma tu nasciste ma fattura.
So you saw in this video the beautiful banner behind of us, scritto meraviglioso, and it was a big gift we got from our friend, our supporter, and Al Forrest, and it was a banner he created, he made it to celebrate our 10 years anniversary. So like I said before, we unfortunately canceled two programs for this the season, the 1920 I mentioned before. We're going to do So You Wanna Be Americano in October. And we canceled another fantastic program, Tale of Tales. And it was, we did it 2 years ago, and we got a lot requests and fantastic reviews. And we got a request from the Toronto, Storytelling Toronto, Story Fusion Cabaret, to do this program together. And we had a fantastic guests, Mariella Bertelli, Nagamet Faramad, and Rumina Diaz Barro, and it was a program dedicated to the tales by Giambattista Basile, Il Pentaverone, Lo Cunto di Licunti, the Tale of Tales. Anyway, unfortunately, we canceled, and I hope and we for sure we're going to do this program again. We don't know yet when. So the next program after the Serenade 2, we're going to do a plucking opera 2, because we did this program I think 2 years ago, something like that. Yes, and it was a really, really big success and the beautiful reviews. So we decided to do the plucking opera 2 next year. And we're going to dedicate it. This program is called to be plucking opera to 100 Caruso, because next year, 2021, is going to be 100 years, like the big Neapolitan tenor, he passed away. So, of course, I don't have to say anything about Enrico Caruso, because it's so popular, it's so great. So a lot of people, they know Caruso, the most Italian operatic tenor, the early 20th century, and one of the first musician to document, one of the first tenor to document his voice on the recordings, gramophone, that became popular all over the world. So obviously the Vesuvius Ensemble could not fail, like, to remember with an entire program this the famous Caruso, who Caruso, to thank him, like, the whole world, the first years of the last century, discovered La Canzone Napoletana. So a big thank you to Enrico Caruso to make this this genre popular in the world. Many things we can say about the great Neapolitan tenor, but just recently we were talking, me, Marco, and Lucas, and we were asking, we were wondering if he ever sang in Toronto. And we found a beautiful article. We found he sang in Toronto twice. He came twice. The first, he sang in 1908 at Massey Hall. And it was a huge success. But the tickets, they were so expensive. So he promised to come back in Toronto again. So he came back 12 years later, September the 30th, 1920, he returned to Toronto. Following his full concert, Caruso went out onto the fire escape at the Massey Hall to sing an aria for the crowd. They were standing outside, 1,000 people. They could not get or afford the ticket. So that when I was reading this article, I saw in front of my eyes that image, that picture. So this incredible, generous man standing on the fire escape and sing an aria outdoor. He could do, because it was September. Anyway, in this program, the Plucking Opera 2, we're going to explore how we did the last year or 2 years ago. We did this program, some arias from famous opera songs, ariette, canzonette, etc., etc., with our instruments, of course, like the mandolin, the guadagnini guitars, etc. All the summer, we're going to paint a whole program with the particular arrangements. And like I said before, we're going to dedicate this program to celebrate 100 years death, Enrico Caruso. Now, talking about this program, talking about Enrico Caruso, we're going to show you a video with a famous Neapolitan song, arietta, like Caruso used to sing, Avukilla.
Thank you.
So thank you very much, Francesco. Thank you, Lucas, and thank you, Marco.
Thank you, Alessandro.
Again, and to go through this fantastic video, and glad I had the opportunity to see you many times performing live, and I'm sure, and I've seen in the Q&A many of our attendees that remembering some of your performance, and most we had compliments from here from Canada, from Italy as well, to all of you. No question, actually. No really question, mostly compliments that you received from your fans. I have a question, though, for the next season, if you are planning really to, of course, we don't know yet, so it's difficult to make, but Francesco, you have been mentioning the possibility of having a mixed kind of format with performing live and streaming as well. Can you tell us something more about this?
Yes, we are first of all waiting to get more info, of course, for the government, exactly what they want to do with the music organization, with the music live music in Toronto, because the Vesuvius is a small organization and of course we are suffering. Can you imagine like a big organization, like, I don't know, TSO, COC, TAFO Music. So we are all waiting to know exactly what to do. And of course, in the meantime, we are exploring, like I said before, the opportunity to do our concert, live concert, streaming online, because like you know, Alessandro, we use our home, Heliconian Hall, is not a big room, like a big hall. If you think like they're going to reduce the capacity, the like, I don't know, 50% to 60%, so we can have what, 35 or 40 people in the audience, so in the hall, so it's going to be very challenging to support the costs, like every single program. Or the other strategic thing is to play in the street, at the entrance of the most important concert hall in the city. I don't know, something like that.
We have actually a question here in this regard from Canvas Magna. Will you be able to perform some open air concerts? Are you considering, now that the summer is approaching, until the end of June, it would be impossible due to the regulation. But perhaps if the guidelines will change a little bit, it will be perhaps be possible to have some open air. I was actually thinking to use, as you know, the Istituto has a small backyard space that we have been using, and you have
we performed
there. So perhaps it's something we could. I was thinking perhaps we can later in July or in August, if the guidelines will allow us to host, keeping the distance as necessary of and course. So on, perhaps it would be possible to have some open air concert. I think it's a great idea. This will.
Why not? Until we don't know exactly if we are safe or our audience will be safe, I think we prefer to do not play live concert. Right, guys? Good.
Then we have another question that I want to share with you, with the three of you. From Wilma van Berkel, can you tell your audience a bit more about your family history ties to Italy? So this will be...
About Lucas. Marco said before he's coming from a musical family. Not from my side. I used to have my grandmother from my father's side. She was just an amateur, but a lot of notice I got from relatives or family friends or some people from my hometown, they said that she used to have a spectacular voice, and my grandfather was always saying, I fell in love with your grandmother for the singing. So she was working in the courtyard, and she was all day long singing. So that's the only musical part from my side. And of course, my mom, she was an amateur, but singing.
And I wanted to add for Wilma that like a week ago, I discovered something incredible about my family and the musical aspect, because I was doing some research on the mandolin, and actually famous mandolin player sent me some information about some members of the Cera family who migrated to Australia from my region, the Veneto, especially from the plateau of Asiago, and they moved around the 1930s to Australia, and they were musicians but also instrument makers, and they had a huge career, a success as musicians but also as music makers, luthiers, and some of their instruments are actually preserved at the museum in Melbourne, beautiful instruments, mandolins, guitar, and this is very exciting for me, because I'm surely gonna explore more about them and about their repertoire. I heard that they were playing mostly tango music, which is strange in Australia, but Neapolitan too. So finally, I find myself being not the only Veneto playing Neapolitan music outside Italy. It's an amazing story that connects me with these relatives, and so there will be more about this story for sure.
Maybe I could just for a second share my screen and show you the website that Marco found. So this is from the Melbourne Museum in Victoria, and it talks about these relatives of Marco's, Giovanni Cera, Italian migrant mandolin maker and musician. They were apparently really into these kind of harp mandolins. And so they have a couple of examples here in the museum that was really interesting. Maybe I could also share with you a picture. This is an old picture that my mother passed to me of the man here on the left is my Italian grandfather, who was not a musician. I don't really come from a musical family from that point of view, but my grandparents were immigrants from Calabria, and my grandfather played the clarinet, and he was playing in some kind of a little military band. So there was music in the family to some extent. As I said, my grandparents immigrated in the 1930s from Calabria, and I grew up, having a relationship with my Italian grandmother, who spoke a kind of broken English, and I never really had the chance to learn Italian. So I had to learn Italian, in college, taking a university class. And then I spent a year in Milan and tried to improve my Italian while I was there. And then I was so excited to come back and then speak Italian with some of my relatives. And they were all very embarrassed because I had spent my year in Northern Italy, and they thought they were embarrassed because they thought their dialect or their kind of accent would sound strange to me, which I thought was kind of funny.
But you speak very well Italian.
I do my best, but.
I'll be your lunch today. You had a what?
A pasta fazool. Some pasta and beans. That's how my grandmother used to always say it. Anyway, there's a little bit of information for you, Wilma.
Okay.
Cool. And we have more compliments and suggestions.
Questions?
The City Hall has a beautiful stage as well, if you want to perform.
Why not?
Great idea. Yes, definitely.
Why not?
And Can Dance Magnet also encourage you to stream your concerts online, Sisha.
Yeah.
Since I live thousands of miles away from you. Well, then it's a good invitation reason to come to Toronto to see a performance once you'll be able to perform again for the audience.
Or maybe we can get busy and make some more videos.
Yes, good, great idea. Yeah.
I know for sure one of the major presenting sponsor, John Caviendo, is online, he's watching us. A big hug for you, John.
As well. Yes.
Thank you, John.
Yeah. I'm sure many of the in the audience are your supporters and friends and followers.
I can see a lot of private message on my phone, on my messages, and I can see a Q&A here. A lot of people we know, and a lot of people we don't know, but welcome. It's always a pleasure, and thank you so much for your incredible support in this 3 months. We got a lot of beautiful emails from our audience, and we are very, very happy, and from the bottom of my heart, I want to say thank you. And I know I can speak from Lucas and Marcos too. You are incredible. You're incredible people. Sending a lot of messages to support us. It was fantastic. Thank you again.
Playing with Vesuvius Ensemble is one of the great musical joys of my life, and it's been such a pleasure. And I think we can reassure all of you that our commitment to Southern Italian music is pretty strong, and it's not going to be a pandemic that's going to make us stop being committed to that music. So we're going to still find a way to explore that music and to bring it to you.
Sure. Giuseppe Balsamo. Ciao, Giuseppe. Tino. Ciao, Tino. A lot of people. Ciao, Elio. Ciao.
Great. I think we probably can come to wrap it up. If We have no more questions, I see. Again, many friends are sending. And
ciao, Ron. Ron Valentino.
I think we will probably publish this conversation on our on the website of Vesuvius. We have recorded it, so we might put it on online, so it will be available again. I think probably on the website of the Vesuvius and as well on the YouTube channel of the Istituto. And so I hope we can meet soon in person.
I hope so.
All of you with Francesco, Marco, Lucas, and all the Vesuvius supporters. I see here more and more friends are.
Yeah, that's lovely. They're going crazy now.
Pepe Balsamo, Massimo Guida, Jack Wong.
Tatiana, ciao.
Mariella.
Jack, ciao. Massimo. Lovely.
Hey, Jack. Lovely. Mariella is there.
Marco, do you remember Jack?
How could you forget Jack?
Of course I remember Jack.
he bought a mandolin.
One of the tre tenori, no?
He bought a mandolin.
Bravo.
Lui sta studiando il mandolino. Can you believe that?
Molto bene.
So happy.
Bravo, Jack.
Beautiful.
Yep. So, okay, Alessandro, thank you again.
Grazie.
See you soon.
It's always a pleasure to see you.
It's always a pleasure.
It was great, and I think we should repeat it soon.
Thank you.
Ciao. Be safe.
Ciao a tutti.
And looking forward to seeing you all soon, and follow the programs of the Istituto. We're going to have more programs. I just want to remember one that is will happen on our YouTube channel. We will have Romina Di Gasbarro, that has been a special guest with Vesuvius several times, and other Italian singers, Daniela Nardi, Andrea Ramolo, Elisa Citterio, artistic director of Tafel Music, on June 12th, 8 p.m. It will be an all-female lineup. So as you know, June is the Italian Heritage Month, so we are not able to have any initiatives as we usually did in the past live, so we have something online. And this event on the 12th will be one of probably the major events that we have in collaboration with Villa Charities, Comites, Amarcord, another Italian Heritage Month Foundation, another Italian-Canadian Foundation. So please join us on the 12th. And thank you again to all the Vesuvius and to all of you. Take care, everyone.
Ciao a tutti. Bye-bye.
Ciao a tutti. Ciao. Thank you. Grazie. Ciao.